Well, let's get started. Welcome to the History of Philosophy sequence. Let me say up front a note about the origin of these videos if you're watching them from anywhere in the world. This series of lectures on the history of philosophy originates in the fall semester of 2021 at Loyola Marymount University. I'm making these lectures for Intro to Philosophy students. That's the nature of the videos, but you might be seeing them anywhere. You might be anyone. And we're excited to have you join us. But I will be going through the history of philosophy, starting with the pre-Socratics and going all the way up through Immanuel Kant. The idea of these videos is to give you most of the information you need, at least 80 to 90% of the information you need to ace Professor Kovacs's History of Philosophy test at the end of the semester. I apologize that these videos aren't more polished. The university told me that by this time we would have a professional recording booth up and running for professors who want to do things like this. But, you know, we're coming off the tail end of a pandemic. Everything's a little crazy. It's been a little bit slow getting things operational here at Loyola Marymount University, but that's okay. This is still one of the best places in the country for you to study history of philosophy. Well, what do I want to say as an introduction to the history of philosophy? Well, first let me talk a little bit about why we might study the history of philosophy. Somebody once said to me that the history of philosophy is, studying the history of philosophy is a matter of shedding old light on new problems and also new light on old problems. Almost every philosophical problem that you can think of, that you can find debated in the history, in the philosophy journals today, you can trace probably back to the ancient Greek philosophers. In fact, a lot of them can probably be traced right back to Plato. So the philosophical problems that we discuss when we study the history of philosophy are not usually dead problems. They're still live problems that we can examine and think about to this very day, profitably, usefully. We become better by thinking about these age-old problems. Old problems that we today can shed new light on. Old problems, new light, or new problems, old light. We might find that problems we think about today, problems about life, morality, religion, the soul, family, society, politics, love, beauty, truth, whatever, you name it, maybe when we go back in time, we'll find people that can help us think about these problems. Maybe we don't have all the answers right now. Maybe some of the answers are buried in the time capsule that we call the history of philosophy. So if you're taking Intro to Philosophy with me right now, you might be working on term papers about God, the soul, free will, beauty, love, art, truth. All these problems that you could be working on right now, you can also be studying proposals to them that are offered today, yesterday, yesteryear, yestermillennium. The history of philosophy is not quite like, say, the history of science. If you want to study physics, you don't really have to spend a whole lot of time studying Isaac Newton. You don't spend a lot of time studying Principia Mathematica. And if you do, it's only to help you understand general relativity, which replaced Newtonian mechanics, at least at the cosmic level, at the astronomical level. In physics, theories sometimes get superseded, right? Sometimes in the history of science, an old theory has to be jettisoned for a whole new theory. In philosophy, things progress, and they do progress, but a little bit differently. We're often tweaking at the edges of theories. We're often seeing where the theory has to go next. This will make more sense, perhaps, as we get into the history of philosophy itself. But I say that a good approach to the history of philosophy is as follows. They're all with us today. All the philosophers that we study can be with us today as dialogue partners. Plato, Aristotle, Hildegard of Bingen, St. Thomas Aquinas, St. Augustine, Catherine of Siena, René Descartes. They can all be our philosophical debate partners, our discussion partners, our conversation enablers, even now when we study their thoughts on these perennial problems. History of philosophy, when you study it, your mind is opened to new ways of thinking that might not have been open to you if you only studied philosophy of the past 100 years. I could do a semester-long study of philosophy where we read only philosophers who wrote in the past 50 to 100 years. We could do that. And you would learn so much. Your mind would be opened to new ideas. But the new ideas that the history of philosophy will open you to are a little bit different. So, first, what I'd like to do is give some advice, if you're in one of my classes anyway, but even if you're not, give some advice for how to study history of philosophy along with these lectures. Then, I'm going to talk a little bit about the history of philosophy, its nature, some caveats to keep in mind as we approach it. Then at this very end of this lecture, I'll give you an outline of a little bit of what the history will look like. So what do you do with these videos? Well, you can listen to them. You probably have a way of downloading them to your phone if you want to listen to them in your car or whatever. If you're planning to take the History of Philosophy test that I offer, I recommend listening to each of these lectures more than once. Maybe listen to it once like you would in a classroom taking notes. It'll bring back all kinds of traumatic memories from when you were learning online during quarantine, but I'll try to make it a little bit nicer than those dark and scary days were. So you watch my video like you would a lecture, you take some notes. If you have a question, put it down there in the comm box. I'm still paying attention to the comm box. I'll answer questions, especially from students, but strangers as well, perhaps. If you have a question about something I say in the lecture, go ahead and put it down there. Then, listen to the lecture again. You can speed it up, you know, especially if it's on YouTube. You can do the 1.25, 1.5 times. I love listening to lectures at the 1.5 times. Only takes 45 minutes instead of an hour to get through something that way. You can even do twice as fast. Maybe after you listen to it a second time at 1.5 times, you start listening to them in your car while you're out running at the double speed. And what should you be listening for? You should be listening for philosophical arguments. That's what we study in philosophy. Arguments. What's an argument, you ask me? An argument is a set of statements, some of which are meant to provide evidence for some of the others. It's a basic philosophy definition. You can memorize it. It'll help you. You don't have to get bogged down in the details of history and biography. This is not biography class. I'll give some details about that sort of thing here and there, especially if I find it interesting. But don't think to yourself, oh God, remember, commit this to memory. Socrates died in 399 BC. Gotta remember that. It's an easy year to remember, but that's not the kind of thing you should be dedicating your memory cells towards right now. You should be dedicating your mental energy towards understanding the arguments. The philosophers say things. At first, some of what the philosophers say might even sound to you a little, I don't know, crazy. But it's not crazy. There's always some kind of evidence that they have prepared behind the arguments. So pay attention to the arguments. After you think you understand an argument, after you think you understand why Plato had this crazy theory of forms, after you think you understand why David Hume thought there was a problem for inductive reasoning about causality, big words, once you think you understand it, then you have to try communicating it. That's when you really find out what you know and don't know, is when you start communicating it. LMU is a Jesuit school, and the Jesuits have often had a value that they call, in Latin, eloquentia perfecta. What is eloquentia perfecta? Eloquentia perfecta is perfect communication, articulate speech and writing skills. So when you think you understand a philosophical theory and you think you've grasped the argument, get on Skype or Zoom or your phone and call your aunt and uncle or your best friend from high school and explain it in your own words. Convince them. Do it. Convince your Uncle Bob that Plato's theory of forms is right. Do everything you can. Muster all your intellectual muscle to convince your aunt and your uncle that these theories, which sounded so odd to you at first, are actually the most reasonable answers to the questions that we're raising. Once you can do that, then you know you understand the philosopher. Then you are certainly in a position to walk into my History of Philosophy exam A+, no problem. If you don't have someone to talk to, get out your philosophy journal. Write it out. Try to write it in your own words. Get out your laptop. Give yourself a word limit. Say, okay, let's see if I can get Aquinas' argument for the existence of God into 400 words. One substantive paragraph. Can you? Then email it to a friend. See if you can convince someone over email. Maybe you have some questions yourself about the theories. You start to figure out how to answer some of those questions once you start trying to convince your friends and family that the opinions aren't insane. When you do that, you've started to become a true scholar of the history of philosophy. You'll really start to just see what looked like a jumbled mess of colors and ideas take clarity before your eyes. The image becomes crisp and clear for you. You may also find that thinking about these problems does exactly what philosophy is supposed to do for everyone. It helps you organize your own beliefs. You have beliefs, but they may not be well organized at the moment. You have beliefs about right and wrong and beauty and life and what you ought to do and what other people ought to do. You have opinions, I guarantee, about all of these things. But, you know, they're just a hodgepodge of ideas you've picked up along the way. Once you start trying to organize them, then things get exciting. Because, like organizing a drawer, sometimes you find, oh, I don't need this. This doesn't really go in this drawer at all. Get rid of it. Or you find, you know, it would go well with this particular collection of socks. Is gray socks. You need something else in the drawer. Organizing your beliefs will be the same way as you think about the history of philosophy. You'll find that some of your beliefs go together in ways you hadn't expected. You also find that some of your beliefs were just, not the right belief at all. You may find that you need to pick up a few new beliefs along the way. This is how we organize the web of beliefs that we all have to have. We all subscribe to some web of beliefs or others. Thinking about philosophy helps you figure out how to put your beliefs together. So as you study the history of philosophy, think about these arguments that the philosophers are putting forward instead of just memorizing names and dates and things like that. I'll talk a little bit about names and dates here and there, especially when I think that something in the history of philosophy is especially worth remembering for trivia night at the pub. So the history of philosophy, well, here let me say what I mean by, a little more what I mean by history of philosophy. I'm teaching in this series of lectures the history of Western philosophy. Why? Why only Western philosophy? Well, quite simply because that's the philosophical tradition in which I've received most of my training. But don't think for a moment, and certainly don't accuse me of saying, that Western philosophy is coextensive with philosophy, full stop. No, no. Philosophy is universal. Every culture, all over the globe, in every time, has had what you might at least call a wisdom tradition, and what you might also just call philosophy. You can find it in the Far East, Africa, Native American Indians, they had philosophy, wisdom traditions. They had answers to many of the questions that we'll be posing throughout this course. But I am an expert on the Western philosophical tradition. That's the philosophical tradition I'll be expounding on over the series of these talks. That tradition begins about 2,500 years ago in Turkey, of all places. It spreads into ancient Greece, into Athens. That's where it really explodes. That's where we get Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. Then it goes into the Middle Ages, through the Renaissance. We're going to end the history of philosophy in 1804. If there's one real weak point in the history of philosophy, one thing to keep in mind about it, it is that for reasons that you probably can already figure out, it's been historically male-dominated. In ancient Greece, there really weren't too many women philosophers, at least none that we have writings from. Well, is that because women are no good at philosophy? Of course not! That's not why at all. It's because of unjust systems that largely prevented women from going into the schools. It prevented women from having the kinds of careers conducive to writing philosophy for a great deal of history. That starts to change, actually, in the Middle Ages, and it starts to change because of a Christian institution, convents, right? You might say that some of the earliest feminists in the Western tradition were nuns, women who were not owned neither by a father nor by a husband. They weren't owned by anyone except perhaps God, right? So these women went and lived as nuns in convents and monasteries and places like that, and that afforded them an opportunity to start writing some philosophy in the Middle Ages. Then by the time you get to what we call the modern era, which ended quite a while ago, you start to see more women writing philosophy. And certainly now, by the time you get to the 20th century, women are very active in philosophy today. If you come up to my philosophy department here at Loyola Marymount University, it's no problem for me to point to three or four of my female colleagues who are far better philosophers than I am, that publishing really important works right now, and that I certainly have the most respect for. But that's a 20th century development, and one that we should be happy for. But if you're wondering, you know, just in case you were wondering as I'm going through the history of philosophy, why do I speak about so few women? It's not because I think women shouldn't be doing philosophy. No, I'm so happy that women are bringing important insights. They're helping us actually tweak. They're the ones bringing new light to old problems, you might say, right? Aristotle's ethical theory, it's a great ethical theory, lots of fans. In the 20th century, a number of women were able to tweak Aristotle's theory of ethics. You'll talk about that if you take an ethics class. They made some very important advancements and contributions. Did they throw Aristotle out the window? That's not what I think they did. I think they've advanced the theory in important ways. So My intention in talking about the history of philosophy is certainly not to privilege men over women. Another caveat about studying the history of philosophy, especially in the series of lectures I'm about to embark on, I am providing what you might call the traditional picture of the history of philosophy. I'm giving a very traditional explanation of these philosophical theories. I'm starting 2,500 years ago with Thales. I'm going through 1804 with Kant. Now, if you study the history of philosophy with another philosopher, if you go to history of philosophy conferences, things like that, you're going to hear people nitpick some of the details that I'll be giving. What's up with that? Well, when you talk about the history of philosophy, you've always got to try to figure out which version of it you want to talk about. I'm giving a very traditional version of it. Partly because if you were to go study with other philosophers or go to history of philosophy conferences and they're nitpicking on the traditional story, well, it helps if you at least know what the traditional story is. The traditional story starts with Thales. Now, you know, there's all kinds of people at conferences nowadays who say, no, we should start before Thales, or we should jettison Thales and start later. Okay, interesting theories. I'm not saying we should dismiss those theories. What I'm saying is that what you're getting from these lectures is just a standard story that history of philosophy professors have been handing down for generations now. It's the story which, if you know it well, you can go to cocktail parties and talk with all sorts of intellectuals from all over the world, and when they say something about Aristotle, you'll actually be able to have a conversation for a bit with them. No problem. So that's what we're doing. We're looking at the history of philosophy. We're just looking at a progression of ideas. So let me conclude this introductory lecture by talking a little bit about what that's going to look like. I'll move my camera a little bit here, and maybe you can. I'll write on the board, just like I used to do during the quarantine lectures. I divide our history of philosophy into how many parts? 1, 2, 3 parts. Part the first is called ancient philosophy. Ancient philosophy. Ancient philosophy begins with these guys we call the pre-Socratics. And then there's three big names you should know in ancient philosophy after the pre-Socratics. And how can you remember them? You just got to remember that the ancient Greeks had spas. Oh, please don't be like the chap I saw on Jeopardy. All three of them on Jeopardy the other night when Alex Trebek was still with us. It was something about put the three ancient philosophers in the right order of who taught who. None of the people on Jeopardy knew? I couldn't believe it. Well, you're not going to have that problem. You will remember for the rest of your life who the three great teachers of ancient philosophy were. When you remember spa, Socrates taught Plato. Plato taught Aristotle. You remember that? You're not going to make that mistake on Jeopardy. There you go. Socrates, teacher of Plato. Plato, teacher of Aristotle. Spa. We're going to talk about all three of them. We'll probably spend a little more time on ancient philosophy than on the other next two eras of philosophy. Why? Because I find that in ancient philosophy, everything is there. I mean, almost any problem, you can find just tons to think about in ancient philosophy. Read Plato's Republic for yourself. You're going to find so many things to think about as you go through Plato's Republic, this great masterpiece of literature and of philosophy. Where are we going to go after ancient philosophy? Then we go into the exciting world of medieval philosophy. I'm what's known as a medieval. I did my PhD studies in medieval philosophy. In medieval philosophy, we're going to talk about a number of things. I think we're going to talk about four aspects of medieval philosophy. It's going to be the only part in this series where I do the history kind of out of order. I'm not going to be going in strict chronological order for the medieval part of these lectures. The four things in medieval philosophy that I'd like to talk about in this series, the relation between faith and reason, right? Religious questions. The medievals had so much cool stuff to say about these questions. You think you already know what they said, don't you? You think, I know what they said, and it's all stupid. Oh, you just wait. Because after we talk about faith and reason, I'm going to talk about a really weird theory. You're going to find it fascinating. Regardless of what you think of it, it's fascinating. The theory of emanationism. After I talk a little bit about emanationism, I do want to talk about the tradition of medieval female mystics. I want to talk a little bit about those nuns who were in the convents writing mystical literature. It's very interesting literature. It's very different from anything else that's been written anywhere else in the Western canon that I know of. The medieval female mystics were, and I've got colleagues here at Loyola Marymount, both in philosophy, but especially down the hall in theological studies, who have dedicated their lives to studying these medieval female mystics. Super cool stuff. Last thing we're going to do in medieval philosophy is talk a little bit about my main boy, St. Thomas Aquinas. I'm going to walk you through some of his key ideas. Why? Because I like it. I'll say more about why when we get there. After medieval philosophy, we're almost at the end of the history sequence when we talk about modern philosophy. And you're thinking, oh, good, modern stuff. We're getting up to date. Yes, modern philosophy goes 1650 to 1804. And there's only three philosophers that we're going to talk about in the modern period. Because there were only three philosophers in the modern period? No, there were lots of philosophers in the modern period. But I just want to get, you know, if you want to see the whole story, you want to see all the minor characters, all the walk-ons, all the stuff that I'm editing out of the movie, you got to take a course here at LMU called Early Modern Philosophy. But I'm giving you a Reader's Digest of the version, Reader's Digest version of that story. The Reader's Digest version is kind of a play in three acts and with three characters. Those characters' names are René Descartes, David Hume of Hume, and Immanuel Kant. Again, those names are Descartes, Hume, Kant. We'll talk about all three of them when we get to the modern philosophy. And we'll end with Kant. We'll end 200 years ago. It's got to end somewhere. If you want to know the story after Kant, there's plenty of classes you can take here. So, I do hope to have some sort of outline to accompany these lectures. I'll make recommendations about readings if you want to do some primary source readings, but I think you should do the readings after you have some sense for the lectures. Reading philosophy texts is really, really hard. Usually you need a teacher who specializes in the kind of text, either ancient, medieval, modern, to really help you get a sense for how to read a page of Aristotle or a page of Descartes. But if you want to read some primary texts, it's a wonderful thing for you to do. You'll understand them better if you read them after my talks. So I'll make recommendations for readings like that. If you're watching these videos with the intention of taking my history of philosophy exam, well, then I recommend that you also do the secondary readings that I've put on the syllabus. Watch a couple of the videos from the library, all on the syllabus. Okay, here we go. I'm excited. It's the history of philosophy. It begins way back with a guy who fell in a well.